Chicago Soul Market. Oh, he keeps a bunch of fillies in a shanty town, near the corner Monroe and Peor Street. And they're not foreigners either. They're American girls. No wonder he can make a bet like that on a mere chance from a roll of yellow backs. The speaker was the Madame of Peor Street Resort. The listeners, a motley crowd of women gathered in the rear of a popular saloon and gambling house not far from the corner of Green and Madison Street, on the seething, congested west side of Chicago. These women had assembled in that screened back room to risk their hard-earned or evil-gotten money on the horses of the Louisville racetrack. There sat a little 18-year-old brown-eyed milliner, her dissipated face hollow and drawn from worry and lack of sleep and an insufficient quantity of nourishing food, while near her a white-haired old lady in shabby black was tightly grasping two quarters, her entire worldly possession. Just across sat a well-dressed woman restaurant keeper, a young Eastern Star, and half a hundred others, above all of whom shone the yellow-haired madame of the Peor Street Resort, the star patron of the great gambling room for women, each one of whom was eagerly beckoning the well-groomed bookmaker, feverishly anxious to get her pittance on the racetrack favorite, when a connecting door was pushed suddenly open, and in rushed a fashionably dressed, brutally faced young Russian Jew, holding loosely an immense roll of money, tens, twenties, hundreds. He counted them until $300 had been placed to win upon a clocker tip in that day's last race in Louisville. There was a grim, deadly silence, eating, unbearable silence, in that gambling room as they waited the ring of the telephone and the name of the winner. Again the yellow-haired madame's voice screamed shrilly out, for she was indeed ill at ease. Her money was all on the favorite. Yes, a bunch of American fillies, peddled out at 50 cents an hour to all comers, black or white, sick or sound. No wonder he could make a play like that on an outside chance. $300. My heart stood still almost. The thought flashed through my brain that the wager meant hundreds of hours of shame and slavery and horror to those girls in the shanties down on Peor Street. Some mother's girl, every one of them. I sat still for a little while and watched the feverish, anxious throng about me. My heart kept going faster and faster until I could bear it no longer. American fillies, and body and soul under a brutal Russian whoremonger. I slipped quietly out into the street. Night was coming on, and I walked down Madison and south on Peoria. Yes, there were the shanties, poor, wretched hovels, every one of them. Out shone the flickering red lights. Out came the discordant, rasping sound of a rented piano. Out belched the shrieks and groans of drunken harlots, mingled with the curses of taskmasters in a foreign tongue, attracting the attention of the hundreds of laborers, negroes and boys, as they walked home on Peor Street from their day's work. On I went until I came to a little shed just north of the Sum Saloon, occupied by one Shelstead at the corner of Monroe and Peor Street, and, checking my steps, I looked around me upon the squalid, wretched scene. I was in the midst of prostitution at its lowest, the heart-breaking dregs of Chicago's 30,000 public women. Yes, there they were, the fair young American girl, the stolid Russian Jewish, the middle-aged syphilic harlot, living, prostituting, and dying like so many hurt-broken moths around that great red light. Chicago's West Side Soul Market, their poor, wrecked, foul-smelling bodies sold day and night from 25 to 50 cents an hour to all comers who could pay the pitiful price demanded by their brutal, soulless masters. As I looked, the burning fire of intense pity entered my soul for these drug and drink-sodden, diseased and chained slaves, my sisters in Christ, and this great, free American Republic. and so with a heart-consuming desire to know more of the lives of these scarlet women, and to help them if possible, I began at once a thorough personal investigation of Chicago's public slave market, visiting these people whenever occasion occurred, talking with them, gaining their much-abused confidence, until I gradually learned the inside lines of the saddest story America has ever known since the black mothers of our Southland were torn from their black and white babies, and with shrieks of agony and heartstrings bleeding and soul rent with blackened horror, were sold to death upon the plantations of Louisiana and Mississippi. And I want to tell you who read this, and who think there is a little truth in the now much agitated question of white slavery in America, that in the dives and dens of our city's underworld, I have heard the shrieks and heart cries and groans of agony and remorse that have never been surpassed at any public slave auction America has ever witnessed. As these girls, many of them oh so young, realize their awful fate, with scalding tears and moans of horror, shut out from their hearts and lives father or mother or husband and child, and turn their sob-shaken, tortured bodies to face the years of final, relentless wretchedness and woe, to be at last thrown out sick and broken, to die in some alley, or to be carted off to Dunning Poorhouse, to gradual physical decay and a pauper's burial, with a grave of obliteration, while those who sold them just a few years before go out in their diamonds, fine linen, and their great automobiles to buy up more girls. It might even be your daughter, father, mother, or it might be mine, to fill the vacancy in the ranks of those vast army of white slaves. A woman said to me the other day, and it was in a lofty, sneering tone, too, I doubt if these women are ever coerced or even imposed upon. Listen, read, then listen. Sitting in my office one afternoon, I listened, my blood almost freezing, to the following story vouched for by a Mr. C., an immigration inspector and brother of a well-known Chicago reform worker. Here it is as he told it to me. One evening, some time ago, I was looking up a case down in the 22nd Street Red Light District, and visited and inspected, looked for immigrant girls held illegally. A certain house of the lower class in that neighborhood of prostitution. While in that house, I noticed a young woman lying very ill, in the last stages of pneumonia, if I remember the story exactly, and in a semi-conscious condition, and to my horror upon inquiry, I learned that in the rush hours of business, this helpless, pain-racked young woman was still open to all comers, holding an accredited room check. Dear friends, there are two stories heard and known every day around the city's seething blood-red soul market that cannot be put into print. Stories, though, that they were there to become known, would make decent Chicago rise as one man and cry with a voice outspeaking Fort Sumter, white slavery in Chicago and in America must cease. During my years of study of this question of prostitution, I learned to know personally many of the characteristic white slaves of the West and South Side, the Levees, one Alice I shall never forget. Beautiful aside from her dissipation, a high school graduate, grammar and syntax perfect, manner most exquisite. Alice, seduced at 18, was at the age of 21, away down the line in the West Side Levee underworld. I used to talk many times with Alice as she sat in the back parlor of the house on Peor Street, the one that gave her shelter, awaiting her call of next to go upstairs with whoever, Negro, white, foreign, or Chinese, might buy for $1, one of the dollars of the Republic on which is eternally stamped the blessed words, In God We Trust, the possession of her beautiful body for 1 hour. Smoking, always smoking, her doped Turkish cigarette. Alice told me much of her life, both in years gone forever, and of a daily levee existence. She told me of a father, mother, and a beautiful home, of a lover who came into it and led her away by night into Levy slavery, of the awful disgrace and disinheritance, of a little baby that she only knew an hour, of insane remorse and anguish, until at last she could stand and scream with all the mental pain until some whoremonger knocked her senseless. And then now she would fall away to some nearby shandy saloon and drink herself helpless to forget. As far as I know, Alice is still on Peor Street. And oh, men and women, there are 30,000 of these Alices in Chicago's great blasting soul market today. United States Attorney Sims puts the average life of a prostitute at around 10 years or less, while other excellent authorities put it as low as 5 years. These women must constantly drink any and all drinks purchased for them by visitors, as much of the business revenue is derived from the sale of these drinks, thus forcing them at all times into a half-drunken condition, rendering them helpless to control the abnormal, sickening, mind and body-wrecking demands made upon them by the gonorrhoe, syphilitic, and sodden wretches of whom not 1 in 10 is capable of any normal sexual coalition, yet whose debauched, drunken desires and requirements, no matter how unnatural and revolting, must be satisfied by the use of the bodies of their hopeless victims at 50 or even low as 25 cents an hour. Very few young women entering this cesspool of prostitution are able to live therein an average of 8 weeks without becoming infected with one or more of the loathsome diseases of this underworld. And this ruined and horrible, they live on and on for 3, 4, maybe 6 years. And at the end of the time, 30,000 pure young girls, gathered from prairie homes, village firesides, and profound of our own suburban and city families, must then march out into this great soul market to take the place of the broken wretches whose decaying bodies are cast into the refuse of our alleys and sewers to become the menace of every girl and boy and drunken man who comes within their clutches or sets foot within their alley hovels. The end of the way. At about 10 o'clock on Saturday evening, September the 19th, I boarded a West Madison streetcar, and transferring north at Halsted Street, alighted at Lake and walked west to Lewinkie's Saloon at the corner of Lake and Green Streets. Going around at the side entrance upon Green Street, I discovered in the wine and back rooms of the wretched place a crowd of 50 drunken, dirty, diseased men and women, most of them most foul-smelling. The young white girls huddled in with the worst mob of Negroes, whites, foreign and Chinese I have ever seen in Chicago slums, all cursing, drinking, singing, and blaspheming in plain view and hearing of the street. I stopped a moment to make sure I was making no mistake in what I saw. I then crossed the street to interview the dark-eyed little foreign girl who at its door was boldly soliciting the trade for the saloon and all of its adjacent evils just opposite. I walked on down to Peor and south upon that notorious street, the row of houses running from Lake to Randolph Street. There were approximately 600 white slaves, diseased, crippled prostitutes of the lowest class, dumped from the city's cleaner dives. And on the night it was almost impossible to push one's way through the mass of men, boys, white, Negro, Turk, Polack, all gathered in front of these places of public abomination. At the corner of Randolph and Peor Street, several earnest men and women were holding a little gospel meeting, and stopping with them, I counted during the 30 minutes I stayed there, 640, approximately, men and boys, who stopped in front of our or entered this horrible flesh market. As I left the scene, a young girl, in a drunken, filthy, diseased condition, slipped out of an alley and followed me, asking me to help her. As we sat upon the steps of St. Peter and Paul Cathedral, corner of Washington Boulevard and Peor Street, she told me the worst, most heartbreaking story of wrong and vice and ruin I have ever listened to. As I left that west side levee of vice, I knew I had seen prostitution at its lowest ebb, and that from these holes of horrible finally went those awful alley women of the night to sell their soul and trail their black disease to any young boy or drunken man who could give them a few cents, or even the price of a drink of whiskey. Coming down Custom House Place one night, about 10:30 o'clock, I overtook, without their knowledge, six boys, ranging from about 12 down to perhaps even 7 years. Three of them I knew fairly well. Following them from shadow to shadow, I gathered sufficient of their low-voiced conversation to make me certain they had been holding an orgy in a nearby cellar or basement with a drunken harlot, and that together they had paid her the small sum of 17 cents for this damning, soul-destroying commerce. One boy, a lad of 9 years, had been wheedled by his companions into paying 10 cents of the sum, and was arguing for the return of at least a part of his money, because of the age and helplessness of the woman, and the extreme short time allowed him by his companions in his relations with her. Mr. J.G. Sloan, when he was superintendent of the John Worthy School, which is a local juvenile municipal reformery, reported that one-third of the street boys sent to him are suffering from the loathsome disease and distempers of the red-light district. Nor is this to be wondered at when we consider the fact that sexual commerce may be purchased almost anywhere in South State Street and in the West Side alleys for the remarkably low price of 10 cents, or even a glass of beer or whiskey, from the gonorrheal, syphilitic denizens thrown out long ago from the better-class houses of prostitution to live off of the half-drunken men and boys to be found in swarms along South State, Halsted, and South Clark streets. Almost invariably, the street boy, haunting these underworld sections of our city, is first led into sexual sin by one of the crippled, half-rotten, yet painted vampires of the street, whose only care or hope is a crust of free lunch and enough whiskey or dope to drown for a time at least the last throb of her heart and conscience, and keep life a little longer in her wretched body. And the boy, having purchased for a small fee his own destruction, trails out again into the night, and on into disease and crime and prison and finally death. The average parent of today has a little idea of the temptations which constantly surround and beset the growing boy. I recall a case in Des Moines, Iowa, where a little degenerate girl of 16 caused the moral, and in several cases physical, ruin of 5 young boys. All this happened in an exclusive East Side neighborhood, and under the watchful care of honest parents and friends. So what must be the temptation thrown out to the young boys of our city, when through block after block of our central districts they must come in contact with those whose only mission is to ruin and debauch? It should be the direct object, morally and physically, of every father and mother in the city to banish these parasites, these leeches, who suck the lifeblood of our boys from Chicago's streets. Listen, father, mother, there are 30,000 pure, dearly beloved young girls growing up in our midst today who within 5 years must, under their present business system of white slavery, be put aside further, mother, home, friends, and honor, and must march into Chicago's ghastly flesh market to take the place of the 30,000 helpless, hopeless, decaying chattels who now daily, behind bolts and bars and steel screens, satisfy the abominable lust of approximately 210,000 brutal, drunken adulterers. I believe, as I write, that the final solution, or solving of this reeking, hideous question, lies in the moral and Christian teaching and protection of the growing girls of our land. I believe in rigidly enforced law that keeps girls under legal age and unattended off the downtown streets at nights after a reasonable hour. Harry Boulding, the convicted white slaver, in his confession before Judge Newcomer and State's Attorney Rowe, said, We would be sent out by resort keepers to work up some girls, from whom we were paid from $10 to $50 each, though the cash bonus was much more. The majority of them were girls we met upon the streets. We would go around to the penny arcades and nickel theaters, and when we saw a couple of young girls, we'd go up and talk with them. I will say for myself, I never took a girl away from her home. The girls I took down there, I met in the stores or upon the streets. There is a league of masonry worldwide that makes it possible for a mason anywhere, in trouble or distress, to raise his hand toward the heavens with a certain sign, and if there be a brother mason within reach, that brother, no matter what nationality, kindred, or tongue, is sworn to give him all needed protection. Listen, father, mother, sister, listen, brother. Today, from beneath Chicago's awful moral sewage system, which has sucked their hearts and souls under, 30,000 troubling hands are held up to high heaven, and to you, for help. Hands reeking with the blood on which some whoremonger has fattened. The hands through of your sisters and of mine. And I believe that here in Chicago, the greatest market for white slaves on the continent, should be formed a league that would become worldwide, of earnest, law-abiding men and women whose efforts, united with those of the proper police, municipal and federal authorities, would make it practically impossible for a girl to be sold into or compelled to lead an immoral life. And through these influence, such open, publicly protected flesh markets as our red light and levee districts would be banished forever from Chicago streets. I believe with all my heart that this can only be accomplished by agitation, by legislation, and by the ballot, and hopefully by the power of God, directing a great national army of the well-informed, the moral, and Christian men and women against this vast, thoroughly organized, well-administered, and heavily financed public horror of our republic. I believe in helping, God knows, with heart and hand and money, every fallen, or as one has put it, every knocked down woman in our land, whom there is the slightest chance to help in any way. But I believe, first of all, in using every known measure to keep the girls from falling. You and I live beneath the only flag in all the world that has never known defeat. And the very basic principle upon which that flag is built is the human liberty and human protection. And so, by personal work and cooperation with every other reform and labor organization for the uplifting of womanhood, by song and by prayer and the power of the cross, let us set ourselves to help these helpless ones in our midst until the angels shall take up the mercy, the story of shame and bitterness, and wrong, and bear to all the world and to heaven itself the sweet, swift acknowledgment that you are your brother's keeper. The only place of its kind in Chicago, 5,040 nights lodging, and over 6,000 meals furnished to homeless women by the Women's Shelter, 733-735-737 Washington Boulevard, near Halsted. During the year ending September 1, 1911, 17% of these women have been aided into honest employment. 100 girls have been saved from lives of sin and given a chance to earn a respectable living. Our doors are never closed. We are in touch with every slum and vice district in the city, every prison and hospital, and with the poorhouse at Oak Forest. We are non-sectarian and cooperative with all reform and Christian works. 12 Christian homes and a municipal lodging house care for the friendliest down-and-out man. The Chicago Rescue Mission's Women's Shelter cares for the friendless, the down-and-out, the woman. Our shelter is not a rescue home, in the ordinary sense of the word, but a place where a clean bed, food, coffee and clothing may be obtained by any homeless woman. not a subject for police interference, for one or more nights as she needs, and where she is given definitive aid to immediate employment and assured of shelter until she receives her week's wages. 5,040 nights lodging, together with over 6,000 meals, have been furnished to the cold, hungry, and stranded girls and women this year alone by our institution. 70% of these have been aided to secure honest employment, but scores have been turned away because we lack the equipment, the warmth, and the funds to aid them. Our work reaches every slum and red light district in the city. The hospitals, the prisons, the poorhouses, everywhere. Everywhere unfortunate women are found. We cooperate with all churches, missions, employment bureaus, charitable institutions, and all throughout the city. Our institution has 31 large rooms. What we need is we need to add 40 more beds. We need better hot water systems. We need a systemic employment bureau. We need another good outside worker. We need coffee, we need clothing, and we need coal. We need your help, generously, in a supreme effort to raise $1,000 in which to accomplish all of these things. The year ending of August 31st, 1911, the number of nights, lodgings, furnishings by the Chicago Rescue Mission's Women's Shelter, 5,040. Number of meals, 5,200. Special lodgings, 489. Specialty meals, 677. Calls and distributions of fruit at Oak Forest Poorhouse, 4,914. Religious services at the White Cross Women's Shelter, 26. Jail, court, and slum visits, 1,210. Reformed literature distributed pages, about 300,000. Yours and his, the Chicago Rescue Mission, 733-7535, 737 Washington Boulevard, near Halsted, Chicago, Illinois. Phone Monroe, 4833. Miss Jean T. Z. Zimmerman, M.D., the President of Chicago Rescue Mission and Women's Shelter, Superintendent Department of Health and Hereditary of the Cook County and Chicago. Please do what you can.